Hey guys, so in this lecture, we're going to be talking about USB. Now, USB is an asynchronous serial communication protocol, and it stands for Universal Serial Bus. So before USB, there were just too many different port types. There were serial port, parallel port, PS2, etc. And the use imposed limitations such as not being hot pluggable. This means that you have to shut down your PC first, connect the device, and then boot it up in order to use it. Quite monotonous, right? And then also, it does not allow for automatic configuration. So it means that you have to manually install the drivers. So they are very limited in implementation due to the requirements in terms of non-shareable IRQ lines. IRQ stands for interrupt request lines, as well as IO or input-output address space. So connectors like the parallel port had way too many connectors and took up a significant board space on the motherboard. This made things really expensive if you wanted to implement multiple peripherals. So in order to solve this problem, all the tech and software giants came together to create a magical standard called USB. And this happened around in 1994. So as you can see, we have Compaq, DEC, IBM, Nortel, NEC, Intel, and Microsoft. And thus, USB was born. So the main reason that USB or Universal Serial Bus was implemented was to provide a replacement for those legacy ports on your computer, as well as to make the addition of peripheral devices quick and easy for the end user. You can connect literally any type of device from printers to mass storage to webcams to MP3 players, cell phones, keyboard and mice. And if that's not magical, I don't know what else is. So let's take a look at the USB speed. So USB 1.0 can throttle between low speed and full speed, which means it can throttle between 1.5 megabits per second to around 12 megabits per second. Then if you go a step higher to USB 2.0, which allows high speed of 480 megabits per second. Now if you go to USB 3.0, you are allowed 5 gigabits per second, and USB 3.1 can go up to a whopping 10 gigabits per second. This is called SuperSpeed Plus. Let's take a look at the USB architecture. Now, USB is an asynchronous serial protocol, which means that there's no dedicated clock line. And if you look closer at USB, so the USB system is made up of hosts and a multiple number of USB ports and multiple peripheral devices connected to a tiered start topology. To expand the number of USB ports, the USB hubs can be included in the tiers, allowing for branching into three structures with up to 5 tier levels. So the tier start topology has some benefits. Firstly, to power each device can be monitored and even switched off if an overcurrent condition occurs. And all this happens without disrupting other USB devices. So both high, full, and low speed devices can be supported with the hub filtering out high speed and full speed transactions. This is so lower speed devices do not receive them. USB is actually an addressable bus system with up to 7-bit address code. This means it can support up to 127 devices or nodes at once. The old 0 code is not a valid address. However, it can have only one host, the PC itself. So PC with peripherals connected via the USB forms, a star local area network. If you look at the advantages of USB, so USB is hot pluggable. As mentioned before, you can plug in your USB to your computer without having to shut it down or restart your computer. USB is also low cost and allows for low cost devices. For most of the devices, you don't need a power supply. And the current that supplies from USB is around 100 milliamps to 500 milliamps. There's also robust error detection. So if you look at the USB host and hub, they manage the power by enabling and disabling power to individual devices to electrically remove ill-behaved peripherals from the system. Further, they can instruct devices to enter a suspend state, which reduces the maximum power consumption to 500 microamps. So these are all the advantages of USB. Now, if you look at the disadvantages of USB, so USB is a very complex protocol to implement compared to UART, I2C, and SPI. Also, if you implement your own device, fees may apply. There was also hardware problems in legacy devices. So the USB flash used to stop working if you pulled it out without safely removing the device. But all this has been solved with current devices. So let's take a look at USB signaling. So we got our USB standard A that you're all familiar with, as well as the USB B standard. So this consists of our VCC or power. We have our ground, which is a minus. And then we have our data lines, which are differential signals, which is called D plus and D minus. Notice that the power lines are longer and thus get connected to the device first before the data lines. So connecting a USB device to a computer is very simple, as you all know. You find the USB connector on the back or front of your machine and plug in the USB connector into it. If it is a new device, the operating system auto-detects it and asks for the driver disk. If the device has already been installed, the computer activates it and starts talking to it. So the USB standard specifies two kinds of cables and connectors. The USB cable will usually have an A connector on one end and a B connector on the other. That means the USB devices will have an A connection on it. If not, the device has a socket on it that accepts a USB-B connector. Now you may be asking yourself in confusion, why not just have one connector? Well, this was to avoid confusion between the host and the device. So A connector head means upstream towards the computer and B connector means downstream towards the individual devices. If we look at the USB pull-up resistors, so USB device pulls one of the data lines high with a 1.5 kilo ohm resistor. This overpowers one of the pull-down resistors in the host and leaves the data lines in an idle state called J. The choice of data lines indicates a device speed support. So full-speed devices pull D plus high, while low-speed devices pull D minus high, as you can see over here. So in fact, the data is transmitted by toggling the data lines between the J state and the opposite K state. If we go back to USB signaling, as you mentioned, we got the J and the K state. So serial data is sent along the USB in differential or push-pull mode, with the opposite polarities on the two signal lines. This improves the signal-to-noise ratio by doubling the effective signal amplitude and allowing for cancellation of any common mode noise induced in the cable. The data is sent in a non-return-to-zero or NRTZ format. This is to ensure that a minimum density of signal transitions. USB also uses bit stuffing, which means you add an excess zero, which is inserted into the data stream after any appearance of the 6 consecutive 1 bits. 7 consecutive 1 bits is always considered as an error. Now, if we had to look at the USB 4 main data transfer types, so you got the control, isochronous, bulk, and interrupt. Let's take a look at each of these. So control transfers exchange configuration, setup, and command information between the device and the host. The host can also send commands or query parameters with control packets. In isochronous transfers, this is used by time-critical streaming devices such as speakers and video cameras. It is time-sensitive information, so within limitations, it is guaranteed access to USB bus. Data streams between the device and the host in real time, so there won't be any error correction. And then we have bulk transfer. So bulk transfer is used by devices such as printers and scanners, which receives data in one big packet. Here, the timely delivery is not crucial. However, bulk transfers are fillers, so they claim unused USB bandwidth when nothing more important is going on. And then we have error correction on top of this, which protects these packets. And then the fourth one, which is interrupt transfers. And this is used by peripherals exchanging small amounts of data that needs immediate attention. It is used by devices to request servicing from the PC host. So devices like the mouse or keyboard come in this category. Error checking also validates the data. So before I move on, if you like any of these devices that I've shown in the slides, you can check the links down below for the link to their pages. Okay, so moving on. Let's take a look at the USB protocol. Now, like I mentioned before, the USB protocol is extremely complex. So with I2C, you had one standard protocol. Over here, we have multiple packets that we can send, or multiple packet types. We got the handshake packets, token, data packets, pre-packets, as well as the starter frame. These are just some of the packets that form part of the USB protocol. So if you look at the handshake packets, So handshake packets consist of a PID byte, which stands for product ID or product identification, and they're generally sent in response to the data packets. The three basic types of handshake packets are the ACK, which stands for acknowledge, and this stands for that the data was successfully received. Number two, which is the NACK, or not acknowledge, indicating that the data cannot be received at this time and should be retried. Number three is the STALL, and this indicates that the device has an error and will never be able to successfully transfer data until the corrective action is performed. So USB2 adds two additional handshake packets, which is called NNET, and this indicates that a split transaction is not yet complete. And then number two, which is the ERR handshake, and this is to indicate a split transaction has failed. The only handshake packet the USB host may generate is the ACK or acknowledge. If it is not ready to receive data, it should not instruct any device to send any. So if we move on to the token packets. So token packets consist of a PID byte, as we mentioned before, was product ID. And this is followed by an 11-bit of address, as well as a 5-bit CRC, which stands for cyclic redundancy check. That is a error checking method. So tokens are only sent by the host and not a device. There are three types of token packets. So you get in token, which informs the USB device that the host wishes to read information. And then you get number two, which is the out token. This informs the USB device that the host wishes to send information. And then you get number three, which is the setup token. This is used to begin control transfers. In and out tokens contain a 7-bit device number and a 4-bit function number. And this is used for multifunction devices, and then command the device to transmit data packets or receive the following data packets respectively. Okay, so if we move on to the data packets. So there are two basic data packets. You got data 0 and then data 1. So both consist of the data PID field with 0 to 1 or 2, 3 bytes of data payload, along with a 16-bit CRC or cyclic redundancy check. They must always be preceded by an address token and are always successively followed by a handshake token from the receiver back to the transmitter. So number one, if you look at it, the maximum data payload size of low-speed devices is 8 bytes. This is very low compared to the maximum data payload for full-speed devices, which is 1023 bytes, which is 1023 bytes. For high-speed, it's 1024 bytes. And also, data must be sent in multiples of bytes. Okay, then, if you look at USB 2, it added also data 2 and mData. mData stands for metadata packets. They are only used by high-speed devices doing high-bandwidth isochronous transfers, which need to transfer more than 1024 bytes per 125 microseconds. This allows for a data transfer of 8,192 kilobits per second. Okay, so hopefully you're still with me. We're almost there and almost finished with this lecture. So if you look at pre-packets, certain low-speed devices are supported with special PID value, and then called the PRE. This marks the beginning of a low-speed packet and is used by hubs, which normally do not send full-speed packets to low-speed devices. Since all PID bytes include 4 zero bits, they leave the bus in a full-speed K state, which is the same as the low-speed J state. It is followed by the brief pause during which the hubs enable their low-speed outputs, already idling in the J state, and then a low-speed packet follows. This is the beginning of a sync sequence and a PID byte. All this ending with a brief period of SE0. So full-speed devices other than hubs can simply ignore the pre-packets and its low-speed contents until the final SE0 indicates that a new packet follows. Okay, so finally, the start of frame packets. So every 1 millisecond, the USB host transmits a special SOF or start of frame token. This contains an 11-bit incrementing frame number in place of the device address. This is used to synchronize isochronous data flows. So high-speed USB 2 devices receive a 7 additional duplicate SOF token per frame, each introducing 125 microseconds. Okay, so that is it for this lecture. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have any questions, please let me know down below. If you liked any of the devices I showed earlier, Please check the link down below as well in the description. And please don't forget to like, subscribe, and share. And I'll see you in the next lecture. Thank you for watching.